What I would like to talk about a little bit is about the multi-layer interlayers. My colleague Wim Stevels gave a nice overview yesterday about the effect of the interlayer on the effect on the stiffness of the material. And where, depending on the norm, you had different approaches, you had different ways to calculate it. But every time you could see that the interlayer is bringing an additional stiffness to the laminate. Now, the limit of that was that in every case, he was talking about monolithic systems. So he was talking about a monolayer. Now, what's happening in case you have a multilayer system? And the content of the presentation I would like to focus on a little bit today is, well, let's start probably with a problem statement. And then what's the approach that we have been taking to tackle this problem? What did we do with dynamic mechanical analysis? How did we do the master curve generation, which for a multilayer system is not always straightforward? The question is that still valid? Is that still something you can do? We have been looking into relaxation spectrum and Prony series. I'm going to elaborate a little bit more on that, on how that's working. I need to get back here. We have been looking at finite element modeling in order to prove that the multilayer system is working and how we did that before coming to some conclusions. Okay, what's actually the problem statement? Well, what we see nowadays is that architects, construction companies, are asking more and more to get mechanical properties of the interlayer, mainly to calculate the stiffness of the system and mainly to see how the system is going to deform under different load conditions, mainly wind load, but also other systems. But in order to do that, well, we need to have those mechanical data. And how are we going to do that for a system which actually looks like this, where we have a multilayer system? And it's not surprising that the multilayer system I'm going to talk about here is the acoustical interlayer, which is nowadays on the market, which is existing out of three different layers, for which the middle layer has completely different mechanical properties compared to the skin layers. So how are we going to approach this system with the mechanical analysis? And then the other thing is, in order to be exact, in order to calculate those systems, we need to have exact mechanical properties on every individual interlayer. The problem is that on that core layer here, that nothing has been published, and that probably in the future, nothing will be published on this specific layer. So how are we going to tackle this? Well, that's something I don't want to talk about, but yeah. The question is it straightforward to do that? Well, it's not so straightforward. And as an example, what I've been showing here is, suppose that we are doing a dynamic mechanical analysis on the three-layer system together. What we see when we look at the tank delta value, which is actually the ratio of G prime, G double prime over G prime, what you can see there is that, of course, we are measuring two transition values, one for the core layer, which is this one for the skin layer, which is this one. Now, if you take the skin layer separately, so if you only measure this layer over here, what you can see is that the tank delta value is different. And it's not only different in size, there is also a shift of approximately five degrees between the fact that you've measured it as a single layer or that you measure it in the multilayer system. So measuring on a multilayer system is not really so straightforward. So the question is, can we do that? Well, what we have to do and what we are going to tackle today is it possible that by looking at, or can we measure this multilayer system completely and come up with some kind of equivalent modulus for that multilayer system? And how is that comparing to the fact when we are looking at the individual layers separately to see what kind of comparison do we have in those two cases? Another thing, another problem that we might face is that the TTS principle, so the time-temperature superposition, is that actually working at the moment that you have a multilayer system, which is also not straightforward. Okay, let's move on. and see what we can do here. The starting point actually is that, well, we are going to do that, and we are going to measure the three-layer system, but we are going to do that in shear mode and not in tensile mode. Why are we going to do it in shear mode? Because we are interested in the stiffness of the material in the bending deformation. And in bending deformation, what you have is that the material, the interlayer, is going to be deformed in a shear deformation. So that's why we are going to do the measurement in the shear mode. And experimentally, and what did we actually do, or how did we tackle the problem? Well, in the beginning, we have been measuring master curves of core layer, skin layer, separately. And we have been measured also, or we have been measuring also the three-layer system here in one go. Now, we have been using two different multilayer systems here, which are in composition identical. Only what is different is the relative thickness of the core layer compared to the two skin layers. But for the rest, the composition of those two is different. We have been doing frequency sweeps in the range between minus 30 and 90 degrees. Why did we stop at 90 degrees? Well, first of all, because above 90 degrees, there's no real interest. Material is becoming so soft that it's not bringing any additional property to the multilayer. But also because once you go higher than 90 degrees, the TTS principle we know for PVB is failing. So that's why we said we have to limit ourselves to that particular value. Another thing is that the strain in which we have been doing the measurement, we have limited that to the linear viscoelastic region. And that has already been tackled yesterday a little bit by Miriam Schuster from the University of Darmstadt. And we come approximately here to the same conclusions in the sense that here for a particular product, and actually this is for a stiff PVB, this is not for the material I'm showing here, but we have been looking at the linearity of the G prime and the G double prime as a function of the strain. And what you can see is that for a material with a glass transition temperature of around 40 degrees, that at 20 degrees C, where you are really below the glass transition temperature, that what you see is that linearity is limited to approximately 0.2%, so to a very, very low value. At the moment that your temperature is increasing, the linearity limit is increasing as well, and where you are at 120 degrees, it's not a complete melt, but at least you see that you have linearity up to 100% almost. So clearly, there is a clear dependence of the linearity limit on the temperature, but mainly, actually, the linearity limit is depending on the relaxation time of the material. I'm not going to elaborate on that, but the dependence is actually on the relaxation time of the material, and that relaxation time is becoming smaller at the moment that your temperature is getting smaller. Okay. Next step, we have been doing experiments on three different DMTAs. Why did we do that? Well, there is what we have seen in the past, that the results might depend from instrument to instrument. I'm not going to show data on this today, but what we can see is, of what we have seen, is that there are some small differences, mainly in the transition point. And for the three systems, they are equipped with a convective oven, so actually the temperature control should be identical, but even in this particular case, you can see that there are some small differences in properties. Geometry, 8 millimeter parallel plate, but that is less of importance here. Then we have been moving, or we have been calculating the Prony series of it. We have been looking at 10 elements. We have determined the shift factor. And then we have been looking at the final element model for four-point bending. OK. Let's take a look first at a global view of the experiment, the experimental data that were generated. And here we have plotted for the skin layer only. So this means that we have only a monolayer system. We can see that G prime red, G double prime blue, that we have a transition region where you can see that the curves are not really flat anymore. They are flat here in the glassy state. They are flat in the rubbery state. But that in the region of temperature between 10 degrees and approximately 40 degrees, there is a strong transition of the G prime and the G double prime as a function of the applied frequency. When we look at the same curve for the three-layer system, for the multilayer system, we can see that we have a much more crowded region of transition in here. And if you look at the transition temperatures, where you can see that you go from the glassy to the rubbery state, that's extended now from minus 50 degrees approximately to 40 degrees. So you really are stretching that transition region if you go to the multi-layer system because, well, it's not surprising, you have a soft layer and you have a rigid layer. Okay, now going a little bit more in detail about the TTS, what is actually the TTS? Time-temperature superposition. Well, time-temperature superposition, what is that? Well, if you want to do an experiment at a very long time scale, it's not always possible that you can do that with your experimental setup. A way to tackle that is that you just do an experiment at a higher temperature in a temperature range which can be accessed by the equipment. And that's actually what you do. So if you do a dynamic experiment, and I'm going to talk here mainly about frequency sweeps, which were explained also yesterday, but if you measure a frequency sweep, and that's a temperature at 5 degrees C, not minus 5, but 5 degrees, this is actually your G prime, your G double prime for the multilayer system. You do the same experiment again at 10 degrees, what you can see, not surprising, that you get a slightly softer material because you are at a higher temperature. Now, what is time-temperature superposition actually doing? Well, it's shifting that curve. And by shifting that curve from the original state that you have over here to the state that you have over here, you can see that you have an extension of the time scale by a factor of approximately 500 at your reference temperature here in this particular case of 5 degrees C. So this is really helping by doing experiments at different temperature. You really can extend the time frame of your experiment. And that can be time, but time and frequency are equivalent. So here it has been expressed in equivalent in frequency. But if you do it over the time, you have exactly the same trend. This is actually the principle of the time-temperature superposition. Now, if we now apply that time-temperature superposition for the skin layer, what does it actually mean? Well, this is the temperatures were measured individually. We had frequency sweeps between minus 30 degrees, 90 degrees. We have been shifting that to one single curve. And this is the dynamic modulus, G prime, G double prime, elastic behavior, viscous behavior as a function of frequency, and you can see that you are almost that you have a dynamic behavior or mechanical properties over 17 decades of time, which is pretty large. What you can see is that the time-temperature superposition is somewhat failing at the very low temperatures. Fortunately, this is in the loss modulus, and the mechanical properties of the laminate itself, the final laminate, is going to be determined mainly by the elastic modulus. So it doesn't harm us that much. If you look to the next one for the multilayer system, there we have the same issue in the sense that also here we have some trouble with the time-temperature superposition and with the exact superposition here, but you also have a similar problem over here. What you also can see in this particular curve that you have two transitions, a transition for the core and a transition for the skin. So also that is not really surprising because you have two different layers with two different mechanical properties. Okay, now if you look at the shift factor and you plot that shift factor as a function of temperature, also there we see quite some difference. First of all, and those curves have been fitted with the WLF equation from which we can get the C1 and the C2. Well, in general, what you can say is that the plot or the correlation between the calculated curve and the dots is pretty, and the experimental values is pretty good, except, of course, at the lower temperature. At the lower temperature, we see that we always have some flattening, which is not really followed by the fitted curve. Now, the reason for that is that, in principle, the time-temperature superposition is only working from the TG on, from the glass transition temperature on to higher temperatures. If you go below that, the change in free volume as a function of temperature is different below the TG and above the TG, and that's actually the reason why you see that flattening here of the curve and why actually the fitting is not working perfect anymore. If you go for the multi-layer system, you also see a pretty nice curve, although if you look pretty carefully, you actually see two curves. You see one over here, and there is a second one over here, which can be an indication that there are two products in there, two different formulations, each are following a little bit their own rule. But in general, you can fit them with one curve, but if you look carefully, you can separate a little bit. Also, what you can see is that the stretch over the temperature is much more pronounced over here than it is over here, which is mainly indicated by the fact that the C2 value is much higher. But again, because you are looking at two different materials with two different glass transition temperatures, you have a larger stretch. Okay. Now, how are we going to move from the relaxation curve to the Prony series? Well, in order to do that, the easiest thing is to go from the frequency domain into the time domain. And we have been doing that using this easy formula. And what you can see here is that now you go from a dynamic modulus as a function of frequency to a relaxation modulus as a function of time, where again you see nicely the two transitions coming from your two materials. But you have really a nice curve which can be used for calculations. Again, two relaxation phenomena are taking place. Going. Probably something, and I will be very short on this because time is running forward. Actually, if we do experiments, we are measuring oscillation, we can do stress relaxation, we can do creep compliance. It doesn't really matter. Those give not independent information. Everything is related to what we are calling the relaxation spectrum, where the relaxation spectrum is nothing else than an indication of the mobility of the polymer chains, each at a different time length. And that's actually what is expressed by the relaxation spectrum. Now, that relaxation spectrum is pretty important because it's the basis for the mechanical analysis, is the basis for the mathematical model that we need for the finite element model. So if we look at the mechanical alternative that we have here, which is mainly, in most of the cases, the Maxwell model, because we are working with linear viscoelasticity, we have that Maxwell model. There are some formulas over here, and this is actually the fitting that we have. So if we look at the experimental logarithmical or the stress relaxation curve that we have here, by applying a logarithmic fitting with this particular formulas, so those are is a sum of exponential decaying functions, each of one representing a spring and a dashpot, we can see that we can describe this experimental curve pretty nicely. See that we are using here 10 elements to do that. This is actually almost the minimum that you need in order to describe that entire timescale. Okay, now what does that mean if we now look at the relaxation spectra for the different materials? Well, look at the core layer, the skin layer of the product. Look at the core layer of the product. There is quite a big difference in relaxation time if you look at the pure materials. If we now bring in the measurement on the multi-layer system, we can see that we are somewhere in between, but we are not falling on this particular curve for this transition. No, it's shifted somewhat. We are not falling on this particular curve for this transition. We are really falling in between the two systems, which is a little bit representative of what I've been showing initially, that measuring on a multi-layer system is not identical as measuring on a single system. Okay, we also have been doing now some four-point bending, because now we have data on the core, we have data on the skin, and we have data on the multilayer. How are we going to take conclusions out of that? Well, we have been doing some four-point bending experiments, and actually we have also built a model for the four-point bending, in the sense that we have a standard setup for four-point bending. We have applied 50 Newton force over here, and we have been following the system over time. Here is a little bit how we are doing the meshing. We have 3 layers of mesh for the skin, 3 layers of mesh for the core, and 3 layers of meshing for the skin again. So 9 layers in total. And depending on the model that we have been using, or these layers are getting identical properties, which is based on the equivalent modulus, or they are getting different properties for the skin and the core. Now, if we now do that calculation, how is that comparing with the deformations that we are finding? Well, here is the experiment. We did one experiment to verify the model. So we have here the force, which is going up. Force is increasing from 0 to 50 newton in 1 second. It's a logarithmic curve that we have here as a function of time. And here is the deformation as measured initially, really nicely following the increase of the force. But here we have, for the last half hour measurement, we are looking at the creep performance of the material. Now, what if we apply the model? What is the model predicting? Well, if you are using the equivalent modulus, we can see that the model is actually over-predicting somewhat the creep at higher, or the deformation at higher values of the time, but also here is nicely following the increase of the force. If you do that for the individual layer definition, in which you are giving to every layer the same data points, we can see that, again, we almost obtain the same final creep values over here, that over here we have approximately the same data, but here in the instantaneous deformation, you can say there is some small difference. This I'm going to skip. Now, what is happening if you now look, and I need to go back 1 minute here. Yeah, what we have plotted over time is actually, we are also interested, what is the effect of time on the deformation? And we have been looking, if we take that not 1 second, but 10 seconds, 100 seconds, to see what is that instantaneous deformation that we are getting here. So we are forgetting the creep, and we are looking at those values. Now, in case we are plotting those values as a function of time of deformation, and we do that at different temperatures, what do we see if we are using both approaches? Well, in case we are at high temperature, it doesn't really matter whether we are using the single-layer model or whether we are using the equivalent model. It doesn't matter, we get the same values. If you are at a very stiff behavior, low temperature, very short times of deformation, the same is valid. We don't see a difference between the equivalent approach and the individual approach. However, at the moment that temperature is increasing, or at the moment that time is increasing, so between this and this, we see that there is a difference. And the difference is so that if we use the separate layer model, that we are seeing smaller deformation, so a stiffer laminate in the calculation. Now, what's the reason for that? Well, the reason for that, if you look more in detail, is the following. Look at this particular data point over here. And look a little bit more in detail what's happening if you look at the strain that we're having on the multilayer. If you look at the strain of the multilayer, and in the case of the individual material model, where we have separate definitions for core and skin, we see that we have a homogeneous deformation of the entire system. If we do that for the equivalent material model, we have the same thing. We have the strain over the complete model of the complete material. Why is that? Well, we have a fully decoupled system. I mean, we have compression, tensor, compression tensor in both systems. Now, what's happening if you go, for instance, in that transition point here where we actually see a difference between the two approaches? Well, if you look at the individual material model and you look at the strain of this particular laminate and you look at the detail of the strain, you can see that here all the deformation is getting into the core layer. So there is no deformation almost in the skin layers. What's happening here is that you're actually increasing the thickness slightly of your glass. You're increasing it with the thickness of the skin. if you do that with the equivalent material model, in which core, skin, everything is getting the same module, the same material model, oops, you can see that deformation now is getting homogeneous and that you have deformation of both skin and core. So this is giving a slightly stiffer performance because in reality, at this particular temperature of 0 degrees, 10 seconds deformation time, this is not deforming. Your skin layer is not deforming. While, and if you take the equivalent material model, it is deforming, or actually it's giving a deformation. And that's the reason why you see those differences and that discrepancy that you have over here. Okay. Conclusions? Well, what we have done is that we have created Prony series for the multi-layer acoustical film. We have created Prony series also for the core and the skin. And we have applied the TTS principle, and we have noticed that the TTS principle is actually working for a multi-layer system. So from that point of view, we definitely can do measurements on the multi-layer system in order to calculate the shear transfer coefficient. That should be no problem. Although, there are some small differences in the results, in the sense that what we notice is that the equivalent modulus approach results in identical stiffness when we have complete coupling or when we have complete decoupling. But in the transition zone, we see a difference. And the difference is that we have a slightly stiffer performance at the moment that we are using the single layer definition. Which means that if you are using an equivalent modulus approach for a three-layer system, that we are actually on the safe side. We are predicting higher deformations than in reality. So if we use, if we base the transfer coefficient on the equivalent material model, then we are at the safe side for this system. Of course, and this is pretty important, this is only valid in the shear mode. Don't try to do that in the tensor mode, because the behavior of the material is going to be completely different. Shear, because the way the deformation is will be going in a shear and a tensor mode for a multi-layer system is giving completely different results. So pretty important, don't use this approach for the tensor mode. Okay? So thank you for your attention, and I would be happy to answer any questions if there are still some things unclear.
Hi there. Did you like what you just saw? If you did, why don't you like the video, drop us a comment below, and share the video as well, since GPD is all about sharing. And to receive more videos in future, subscribe to this channel and don't forget to click the bell icon. Ciao.